doubt that Patricia Wieland was there. And we have no doubt about what her intent was. And Elliot Adams, also arrested, arrested by Dan Ferrazzoli of the Sheriff's Office, identified by Chief Master Sergeant Ramsey, he admitted to the fact that he was also there. He said his intent was to get the government to take notice, and among other things, he said that he knew he was risking arrest. Why did he know he was risking arrest? What does that mean? It goes directly to both his intent and his knowledge of the fact that he was trespassing. He knew that going there put him at risk. He knew that he wasn't supposed to be there, and he knew that he could get in trouble from it.
Judge Judas raised
the question, knowing that he would get, believing that he might get arrested, was based on prior examples at the base, was not, I don't believe, an indication of admission that he knew that he was committing a crime.
Again, I'm going to listen to the testimony and I'm going to look to see what exactly what it said.
Thank you.
Proceed. Thanks, Judge. Judith Bellow was arrested by Deputy Laura Collins. She acknowledged her arrest on the cross of Daniel Bergerman, and I believe Laura Collins even picked her out. In talking about her intent, she said, "I was there for quite a long time," and she stated it was an obligation to raise the issue, to get notice, and to speak and to be heard. And she said, clearly standing in a place where the base didn't want them. Okay, she knew and she had intent to get in the way. She knew that she wasn't supposed to be there. James Ricks Jr. picked out and identified.
I object to that last statement. Clearly we were standing in a place that didn't want us. If you look at what's followed between the time of this trial and the day of arrest, I would say that encompasses what I meant by that final statement.
Again, I'm going to listen to the testimony again to avoid it from my own conclusions.
May I continue, Judge? Judge James Ricks Jr., among other things, was identified by John Fuller of the Sheriff's Office, identified by Chief Master Sergeant Ramsey as being one of the people in East Floyd Road. And he gave a few things. Crimes are not in the grass. Crimes are occurring in the base. Acknowledged that he's been there before. He acknowledged that tonight. Admitted past arrest. He heard the notice and didn't leave. Daniel Bergerman was arrested by Mike Ellis. Admitted he was arrested by Mike Ellis. Admitted past protests. Intent to prevent the 174th attack wing from attacking. And he heard the warning. Judge, he said that he intended to prevent the 174th attack wing from attacking. How do you do that? You stand directly in the road and prevent people from going to work, from getting inside, which is exactly what these defendants did for an hour and 10 minutes. Judge, I want you to take a look at the picture on the screen. It's the video from East Molloy Road that day, okay? Specifically, this is 8:10, okay? If you'll notice here, Judge, you're gonna notice a few things. Okay, you're going to notice 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 traffic cones. And you're going to notice defendants standing in the road, coordinated, blocking any attempt to enter or exit the base. Standing in the pavement on the road.
Excuse me, Judge, I'm really sorry to interrupt. There's an element of interruption which is really not fair to the prosecutor. Is this a repeat of a slide that we have seen? If it is, it seems to me that as a recap, it's entirely appropriate. If this is a slide that we have not seen before...
Well, the videos are in evidence.
They're entirely...
Doesn't it have to be what we saw in the courtroom?
The videos were introduced, as I recall, without objection.
And does that mean the whole video, even though it was not shown here in the court?
That's what I'm taking it to be.
Thank you.
Thank you, Judge.
Your Honor,
Judge, you'll notice.
Excuse me, I'm sorry, Mr. McNamara. But is it fair
that we were shown certain pictures of us allegedly committing the crime of trespass. And then new evidence, this is a new, we didn't see this during the trial.
This is not, the evidence was admitted, it's in the evidence.
The entire, in its entirety.
Remember when you were qualified per se,
yes.
You're held to the same standard
sure.
as an attorney. The time to object with that.
Okay, thank you.
May I continue, Judge?
You may.
Thank you, Judge. So, Judge, you'll notice all eight traffic cones. You'll notice they're all on the road. You'll notice the entrance and the exit to the 174th attack wing on East Molloy Road. You'll notice all of the people with signs standing here, and you'll notice what the signs say. Signs like this one, which is admitted into evidence, which talk about federal crime scene, do not cross. Okay? Judge, we don't need to look at anything than that, really, to come up with what it is. Do not cross. Stop. Pedestrian and vehicular traffic is not welcomed here. But Judge, I want to show you the whole video. I want you to take a look at how this starts, Judge, and I want you to take a look at particularly the first couple of minutes. Judge, you're noticing the signs are being put out, and it's a coordinated effort, as everyone has testified that it has been. Judge, I want you to notice that this sign says stop, and I want you to notice this person and this person putting down traffic cones directly in the middle of the road. Judge, I want to take your attention and I want to stop it right now. Judge, there's a whole group of people right here, some of them which are later arrested right now, and they see this car. You know what else they see, Judge? They see this car, they see it attempting to go in the entranceway, and I want you to watch what they do, because it's very interesting. They stand there and they block it. They move over in front of the car. And I want you to pay attention to how long this happens, Judge. About a minute. I want you to pay attention to this car attempt to come up. I want you to pay attention to the fact that the blinker is attempting to turn left. This car just attempted to turn in there and couldn't do so because these people are standing there. Now, the silver car up on top, the first car that attempted to get in, almost has to resort to driving on the lawn to try and get around them. All of these people are facing this direction, looking at this happen. Okay. A third car arrives. All of them block. Now, a member of the military decides to come out and see what's going on. After they've all attempted to get inside, a fourth car decides to show up. Member of the military talks with him, and then they decide to go on. Now, Judge, I want to take this and I want to stop it, and I want to have you look at something. Judge, there's been some testimony in this trial about protests that occur every week, and they occur right here, right in that grass right there, on the opposite side of the road, on what would be the south side of East Molloy Road. Judge, protests happen there approximately every week.
That's not true.
And there is no one's ever arrested over there. Why are people arrested on the other side of the road? Because they blocked the gate. There's a clear opportunity to protest what these people want to protest across the street. But they chose to go stand in the road. Now, Judge, that goes on for a solid hour and 10 minutes until we flash forward until 9:50. And what do we see, Judge? They're still standing there. Now, Chief Master Sergeant Ramsey testified at this trial that the reason he didn't save the entire clip of the video was because it was inconceivably long. It would have taken an unbelievable amount of time and storage space to keep it. So he just didn't do it because it wasn't practical. But Judge, you see people standing over here. You'll notice that they're all standing there with signs and protesting, and none of them are arrested. These people had plenty of time, plenty of opportunity, an hour and 10 minutes worth of time to move from where they were, to move across the street, to not block the ground, to not block the entrance and the egress. But they all stood there and blocked it anyways. Judge, while this is going on, there's also a protest going on at Thompson Road Gate. Four people are arrested at Thompson Road: Brian Hines, Ellen Grady, Marion Grady Flores, and Martha Hennessy. Well, Martha Hennessy stipulated to the fact that she was arrested there. She admitted on the stand. Brian Hines, he was arrested by Daniel Ferrazzoli. He admitted that on the stand. And his intent was that he had an issue with the base and that the gate was the door to the base. Yeah. And he acknowledged seeing the line of cars. Why'd he stand in the gate? Why'd he stand in the road to the gate? To block it. To make sure that door was slammed shut to anyone that might try and go in. Judge, you know, just briefly, Judge, I can't. There's a ton of talking going on. It's really distracting. I don't know if there's.
I don't hear it.
Okay. I just want to make sure it's clear that you can hear me. Judge, Ellen Grady was arrested, and Laura Collins testified that she arrested her. Marion Grady Flores was arrested by John Fuller, and she admitted during her closing that she was there. Judge, you're going to watch this, and you're going to see the actions at Thompson Road. I want you to note that it's 8:04 in the morning on October 25th. These people walk down the street and stand right in front of the gate. Now, Judge, I want you to also think back to the first video that we watched tonight of my closing argument. And at this time, the entire gate is already blocked off. The main gate to East Molloy Road. What everyone testified is the main gate to East Molloy Road. Judge, you'll notice the same thing. There's cones, there's signs, and the people are right in the middle of the road. And they're going to stand there for a while. This time, they're going to stand there for even more than the hour and 10 minutes people at East Molloy Road stood there for. blocking the road. Now, you will notice, Judge, that there is a fence and that there are things blocking the fence, but the reason that is very, very, very simple. There's actually two reasons for it. One is that the only time that this gate is used is when they can't use the front gate. Coincidentally, we know they can't use the front gate because we just saw it blocked. And we know that the people that blocked it are of the same group as these, as the people that are here, because everyone testified about taking the same pledge, about going to the same meeting beforehand, and it was that it was coordinated. Okay? So we know what their intent was because they're standing in the road trying to block all of the gates. Judge, I want you to watch in a couple of seconds, a red truck is going to pull up. And I want you to watch where the red truck drives. First, we see an SUV that's attempting to drive up from behind a group of cars, and it appears that it's trying to approach this. Okay?
Speculation.
These people are all now pointing to someone that's off the screen to the left. As I said, approaching right now is that red truck. Not one single inch of movement to get out of the way of that red truck. Every single person stood right there. He pulled right up to it, attempting to use the entrance, and was not able to. Why? Because all of these people were blocking it, Judge. With traffic cones, with signs, and we know that at this point, that as Chief Master Sergeant Ramsey testified, that at this point, because the front gate was blocked, they would have opened this gate for entrance and egress. But these people were standing here blocking it, so they never did, because it would have been a waste of time. Also, Judge, this is a military base. They see a group of people. We now know that they weren't of any type of armed threat, but at this time, they're not speculating as to who these people are and whether they're armed or not, or what's going to happen if they open the gate when a bunch of people that they don't know are standing out in front of the gate attempting to approach it. Judge, that goes on for over an hour.
Objection, Your Honor, we're not even facing the gate. Okay, we're not attempting to enter into the base.
Judge, that goes on for over an hour.
Oh, hold on. I'm taking what I'm viewing. So I can determine that for myself.
It goes on for over an hour. And we heard at this gate that Nick Namey, Sergeant Namey, and the officers who are here, the sheriff's officers who are here, the sheriff's deputies who are here, are giving these people warnings. Nick Namey testified to that. And no one moves. After they've been standing in the roadway for over an hour, over 2 hours. They're all still in the road when they're arrested, Judge. I'm not going to show the whole thing, you're capable of watching it, but you get the point. Town Line Road, Marshfield, Carver, Murkovo, and Ray Kramer are arrested. They each admit the fact, Mark Schmidt-Kyver and Mark Colville admit to the fact that they were arrested there, they were standing in the road. Ray Kramer is identified by Jennifer Hanslip, Lieutenant Kurt Daly, and Chief Master Sergeant Hampton. Let's talk about what their intent was, okay? Mark Schmidt-Kyver stated it was possible that he was preventing an attack. Why? Well, because he was standing in the roadway where he thought drone operators were coming in and out, and he was preventing people from going to work and working on the, that might be an operator. He says if he delays one drone operator by standing in the road, he may be a killing is being prevented. Judge, he's standing in the road with the intent to block traffic. Exactly what the exactly what the statute requires me to prove. That's what he admitted to doing. And he said his intent was to prevent the commission of attacks. Why? Because he's standing in the roadway in the morning as people are coming to work. Okay? Mark Colville, his testimony is actually even more amazing. It sheds even a greater light on this. He says regular protesting is not affected when he was asked why he didn't just stand on the grass. He says that his goal was to get between the victim and the victimizer. The victim and the victimizer, to Mark Colville, the victimizer is the person that's trying to go to work, and the victim is some person over in Afghanistan who's allegedly being attacked. His goal was to get between the victim and the victimizer. That's to stand between in the road so that the people that are working at the base couldn't get to work. That's real clear, Judge. He said he was trying to impede acts. The road puts him at risk while the grass is easily ignored. He knew exactly what he was doing. Not only did he know what he was doing on that date, he acknowledged he was part of prior protests. He testified that he had been involved with protests at a Sikorsky plant in Connecticut. And that's really interesting because what he says was very illuminating, Judge. He says, we went in the morning because that's when people were going to work. When did this happen, Judge? This happened between 8 o'clock and 10 o'clock, exactly when the shift changes. What did he say? He said he saw all the cars backing up and he felt pride because he could see them going on forever and ever. Because he was preventing possibly an attack helicopter from being built, so he was saving lives. It's exactly what he did here, Judge. It's exactly what he did here. Ray Kramer. I think really the only thing that can be said about Ray Kramer was when she told Jennifer Hanslip, I'll see you back at the base. This one's a little bit shorter in period of time, but Judge, I also want you to remember it's 9:42 at this point, and at this point, all the other gates have been shut down for 100 minutes. 100. Together, clearly on a roadway. And you can see members of the military looking down here. They see him approaching. This has happened before. It's happened since then. The soldiers right there know what these people are doing, which is to come and stand in front of the gate. So, Judge, it's a military operation. They're not going to just open the gate and see what happens. They're there to protect themselves. So what they do? They put barriers and they close the fence because it's a military establishment. They just don't want anyone walking on. Now, Judge, you'll see, if you take it back a second, I want you to see this car, this BMW, drives up behind these people trying to drive this direction. And what's it have to resort to? Actually driving on an emergency sidewalk to get around him. This car approaches. It's neon. Dodge Neon approaches. And the cones go up. And the signs go up. The federal crime scene, do not cross. Do not cross. That tells you everything you need to know about their intent. That they were there to block people from going past them.
Objection, Your Honor. So does the part of the banner that says, so shall ye reap. I mean, it shows a reaper drone. I mean, it's obvious that we're trying to educate the base personnel to try and stop the murder of innocent women and children.
Judge, I want you to pay close attention to the other cars that attempt to come up at this time. This car right here. Approaches the gate, and it's instructed by this person right here to go that way. This car drives all the way up here. No one gets even not one inch of movement for this car. Not an inch. No one even moves at all to try and get out of the way of that car. Appears to be a Mustang approaches from the inside. This car has since approached the gate, has to back up, and a Trailblazer approaches. Because at this point, the only gate on the base that's open that could possibly have been gone through was this one. The other two have since been blocked by other protesters. Judge, I'm not going to show it to you. I've already shown you enough. Then, this is where the arrests take place. By this time, there's only a couple people still left there, still standing in the road. You can notice Ray Kramer. At this point, they'd already been given a warning, because you can see Lieutenant Daly standing right there. And then they're arrested. Judge, there's been a lot of talk in this trial about the fact that the defendants didn't knowingly do this, the fact that the defendants didn't intentionally block traffic. Judge, I would submit to you that's ridiculous. But I would submit to you there's a number of reasons why. Okay? Some of the defendants stated that they've been to the base before. They know what happens here. Okay? They saw cars pull in, they were told to leave, they stayed there for 110 minutes, were then warned again to leave by Nick Namey and Kurt Daly of the Sheriff's Office, didn't do so, and some of them were even warned another time by the individual arresting officers who asked them to leave and then arrested them because they weren't. Okay? Judge, there is no question at the point right before that they were arrested that they knew they weren't supposed to be there. That they knew they were there unlawfully. There's absolutely no question about that. And Judge, all of those things, I want you to use your common sense as well. You know, Judge, if I walk my dog Bailey around the block and
let's turn his phones off, sorry.
If I walk my dog Bailey around the block and the dog has to go to the bathroom, it goes on one of my neighbor's yards. I go in the yard and I clean it off. Strictly speaking, I may not have. It's hard to determine whether or not I'm there, you know, lawfully. But the neighbor's probably not going to care. They may be annoyed that the dog went on there in the first place. But they're probably going to be happy I cleaned it off. No one's going to come and arrest me. It's a type of incident that happens every day in human life. Okay. But if, on the other hand, then in a situation like that, it might take a minute, two maybe at the most. If, on the other hand, the dog walks up onto the lawn, goes to the bathroom, and I decide to stay on the person's lawn, I start playing with my dog, I start playing fetch, I pop out a lawn chair, take the dog off the leash, the dog starts to run around. The neighbor comes out, asks me to leave. I say, no. The police come and say, hey, buddy, leave. And I say, I may not have entered unlawfully, but at some point along that stretch of the continuum, I certainly remained unlawfully. I had every reason to know that I wasn't wanted there, and I decided to stay there anyways. Especially when I stayed there in over 110 minutes. 110 minutes. So that's, there's no question you're a trespassing judge. Absolutely not one iota of a question about they were trespassing. But they had the knowledge, were there unlawfully, and they remained. Now to the disorderly conduct. Intent to block traffic, pedestrian or vehicular traffic. Well, Judge, each and every one of them, they stood in the road. Everyone of the cops testified they arrested the person on the road. And the defendants who testified all acknowledge the fact they were on the road. You have seen the video and know that they were on the road or in the pavement, in the driveways, entering the base. They all saw cars pull in, and it happened right around the shift change. Mark Goble talked about how important that was at the Sarkozy plant, and it was when people would be going to work. Incidentally, everyone says, if I can get between the work and the operators, I could maybe prevent something. Judge, it's very clear. It's use your common sense. It's exactly what they were talking about. The signs, they stop, federal crime scenes, do not enter. I mean, it's not like they were just walking down the road, just having a trip and fall in front of the base. You know, exactly what they were doing, and they did it intentionally. You know, Judge, I find personally the one thing in this trial that if you want to talk about what shows their intent, look at, everyone says we were there to redress their grievances. Judge, if I was, and just look at the video, and some person over there just acknowledged it. Judge, if I was going to redress my issues with the court, as I've done in my closing argument for probably too long a period of time now, I would face you and I would talk to you. I would speak in your direction. That's how people redress their issues. Not by giving my entire closing argument facing away from you for an hour and 10 minutes. As that person over there acknowledged, and as this video shows, Judge, as all the videos show, all these people are facing away from the base, facing the middle of the road, okay? The government, the grievances that these people want to redress are like over here someplace on that wall, okay? They're not redressing their grievances. They're blocking the people from getting in the way, and Judge, when you're deliberating and thinking about this, I want you to think about this picture. Right here, where these people are facing, what the signs say, and that's all you need to know, because they're guilty of trying to block the traffic and trespass. Just look at it right there. You're standing facing the road with signs. There's grass on both sides of the driveway, of the entrances, at each and every one, but I'll use the East Molloy road gate as an example. There's all this grass, there's these people standing over here who are protesting. That where they could have stand, everyone testified, it wouldn't have been a problem. The problem was blocking the road. Several people had stated that they'd been there before and they'd been arrested before. Everyone knew that standing in the road's a problem. The orange traffic cones? No one has ever used orange traffic cones for anything other than directing road traffic. Especially when you put them in a line, eight in a row, and put them in front of the entrance. Judge, it's got a universal meaning, and it doesn't take an expert to testify. All it takes is common sense, and you see what you saw, and you tell me what their intent was. It was to block the traffic. What this case is not, you know, we've been here for countless amount of hours, and we've been here for what is now 4 days of testimony, and this is the fifth day. What this is not, this case is not, it is a lot of things, but it's also not some things. It's not an accident. There's no accident. They did this intentionally. They stood in the road intentionally. It's not a mistake that it's a road. It's not some, like, hidden dirt path. You know, in the woods. It's very clearly marked as a road. All of the gates. It's not a case where the Air National Guard is required to take some type of extreme lengths to get out of the base. You know, they don't need to do an airlift. You know, we don't need to replay Berlin in the 1940s to prove disorderly conduct or to prove trespass. Okay? The law does not require what is vain and useless. Okay? Everyone at the base knew that the people were blocking it and that there was really no way to get them out other than arrest them. Okay? There's no need to send, you know, an airplane in and get people out to prove disorderly conduct. That's not what it's trying to do. It's also a couple other things not. I recognize that no one was violent or, you know, creating any type of mayhem outside the gates. And there's a reason for that. They're on trial for disorderly conduct. They're not on trial for resisting arrest. They're not on trial for, you know, criminal mischief. They're not on trial for assaulting a police officer. Everyone acknowledges that. That's not what they're charged with. They're charged with blocking the road and being in a place where they know and they weren't supposed to be. And Judge, there's really, when you think about this trial, there's one particular part of this trial that's really troubling. And it is a question that was asked of Chief Master Sergeant Ramsey. At one point during his testimony, he was asked by someone on cross-examination, something to the effect of, why didn't you just fight it out with the protesters? Why didn't you just fight it out? Why didn't you just let the cars at the people? Why didn't you just let the cars get at the protesters? It's kind of amazing when you think about that. You know, Judge, in my office, I have two things that I find of particular value in relation to this case. Two things I take a great deal of pride in. One of them is a list of all the deployments that the 174th Fighter Wing and the 174th Attack Wing have taken during their existence. And those include a number of services to protect and defend this country. Desert Storm, the World Trade Center response, operations, operations Enduring Freedom in Iraqi Freedom. I also have one other thing that I take particular pride in that's in my office. That's the oath of office that Chief Master Sergeant Ramsey signed in 2008 when he re-upped for another 6 years in the Air National Guard. He stated and swore that he would support and defend the Constitution of the United States, the Constitution of the State of New York, against all enemies, foreign and domestic, and that he would bear true faith and allegiance to the same, that he would obey the orders of the President of the United States and the Governor of the State of New York, and that the orders of the officers appointed over me according to law and regulations, so help me God. That's the oath that he took. Judge, to suggest that somehow that Chief Master Sergeant Ramsey would innocently attack people who are standing out there unarmed in front of a gate and somehow instruct people from the base to run them over with a car is just goes beyond the pale of anything that's reasonable. And it also shows what the people's intent was.
No one ever suggested anything of the sort from the defendants. We never threatened the officers or anyone at that base. That never happened in any of the testimony in this trial.
It's a question
that
I'm asking.
That is hearsay nonsense.
And I objected. Okay, well, it's not hearsay nonsense. It was a question on cross-examination that Brian Hines asked him. I objected. I asked, it sounds to me that the defendant is asking Chief Master Sergeant Ramsey if he was, why he didn't allow people to run him over with a car. Judge, you said, well, Mr. McNamara, it sounds like what it's heard sounds to me. Mr. Hines said, yes, that's exactly what I was asking. I withdrew my objection, and then Chief Master Sergeant Ramsey answered the question of why he didn't instruct the cars to run him over. It's not a made-up thing. It happened, and I objected. Go check the record, Judge.
Okay.
I'm going to overrule the objection. I'll check it in the record.
Judge, that question was so far beyond the pale, but it also shows exactly what these people intent were. They wanted to provoke some type of reaction to spread their, to spread what they believed. They wanted to go there and get in the way. They wanted to be seen and be heard and be known that what was going on at this base, they had a problem with. That is the best thing that shows up. This case is really simple, Josh. It's really simple. Each and every one of these defendants knew that they were in a place where they weren't supposed to be, they're guilty of trespass, and they stood there with the intent to block any car from going in or out, creating public inconvenience, with the intent to cause public inconvenience and block any for traffic. Judge, find each and every one of them guilty. Thank you.
The prosecutor had submitted 200 pages of statements of testimony, and during the trial, reviewed publicly as part of examination 10 of those pages. Is what you were saying that it behooves us to explore the other 190 pages?
You're supposed to know what's being offered in evidence.
But even if there is no direct examination in reference to that?
It doesn't matter, because a piece of evidence was admitted into evidence. He offered it into evidence, and as I recall, there was no objection. I'll check the machine.
Okay, so I'm trying to learn for the future.
You're charged with knowing what you're agreeing to, it, without objection, to let in. I want to just pull this thing up.
Your Honor, the prosecutor has all kinds of video evidence about what the defendants did on October 25th. But unfortunately, he can't get a single inch of information about what occurred in terms of drone attacks on the very same day. And I think that would be very revealing as to why, what our intent was to stand where we did and do what we did that very day.
Did you subpoena that information?
No, we haven't.
That was your choice. You were acting as your own attorney. That was your choice. You could have subpoenaed it.
But don't you think, sir, that a drone attack video would be appropriate to counterbalance this peaceful and nonviolent protest?
I'm here. You got to present me with the evidence. If I don't have it, I'm going to decide based upon what I have.
May I suggest, sir, have you ever seen a drone attack video?
In this quick trial, I have not seen a drone attack.
But have you ever seen them just... Judge,
the proof is closed.
Leave me alone.
Yeah, the proof is closed.
Sorry?
The proof is closed. The district attorney is right. You had an opportunity to present that, and it wasn't presented.
Yes, sir.
I was showing that last film with us in front. That's all it showed. It didn't show people at the gate trying to communicate with the base. And I believe his point was saying we were trying to block traffic. There was people at all times trying to communicate with the base unless the personnel made us leave. And one other thing, I think he pointed out Ellen Grady up there getting arrested, which never happened. I'm wondering about the reliability of the information that he's spewing out a lot of information, and some of it is erroneous. Ellen Grady.
Well, it's my job to listen to those particular people, listen to the recordings, look at the whatever's introduced in the evidence, and make that decision.
Okay,
just for the record, I never said that. So.
Yeah, you did.
All right. Last.
It seems like there were new things, Joe. You said they've been in evidence, but can we question what they showed? There was no audio with any of this, and prosecutor made lots of assumptions about what was being said when.
He's allowed to draw conclusions from the evidence just as you are.
I see, okay. And of course, he didn't speculate on whether the defense was standing on public or private land.
Both drew conclusions from the evidence.
Okay.
You drew it, especially on the intent
issue.
I'm
sorry.
I
should have spoken.
You know, you both drew the conclusions.
Is he obliged to provide such evidence to every single defendant, considering that we were going pro se?
I don't understand.
Judge, I offered it.
I don't understand.
I mean, for example, there would have been 15 videos. He would have provided 15 copies of the video.
He offered it. All right. As I initially intended, I'm going to reserve. I'm going to announce the verdict on February 7th, next Friday at 5, as we agreed. I have a lot to review here, and I'm not going to do it tonight. Otherwise, you're all sitting here probably until about 2, 3 in the morning. So I've got my work cut out for me now. I thank everybody for their presentations. It's been informative on both sides. Now it's up to me to figure out the pieces fit together. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. All right.